Well, okay. We have some pretty cool questions today,
right,
Pat. Silver says, why do people raise their hands in church when they worship?
All right, give me a camera. Where's your camera? Camera. That's what I want. What is this?
You are raising your hands.
No, yeah, but what happens if somebody's got a gun on me and I do that? What does it mean?
Surrender.
Surrender. It's a surrender. I've got no weapon in my hand. I'm holding my hands up. I'm surrendering. That's the symbol of an upraised hand, you know. And you see people, they coming out, you know. You see prisoners, they're holding their hands up, you know. I'm not going to try to hurt you. Okay. Well, that's what it means. And the Bible says in Timothy, he says, I've with it men pray in every place, lifting up holy hands without wrath or disputing. So I haven't got a fist I'm going to hit you with. I haven't got a knife I've concealed in my garment. I'm holding up hands, Lord. I'm clean before you, and I give you my all.
That's such a cool analogy. I never thought of that. That's what it is. It
yeah,
is surrender.
But Timothy says, men lift up holy hands. If you want to get a scripture references.
Great.
1 Timothy 2:8. Okay.
Okay. Well, right. Daniel writes, I have met several people in the church who do not seem to show the love of Christ. I wonder how a Christian can exclude another person or make them feel unwanted. This is not what God does. It appears they think they're better than others. What's the best way to react to people who act this way?
Love them. You show love, maybe they'll love you back. But we have that in the Bible, you know. Paul was saying, listen, you got poor people that come into communion and you say, well, if you're going to sit down, sit on the floor, and I want to look after this rich guy and give him a seat of honor. It's just the way people are. And they're people that make folks feel unwelcome. you know, Robert Burns, the great Scottish poet, wrote a poem to a louse. You remember that one? Have you ever read that one?
Refresh me.
Some power the gifty gee me would see ourselves as others see us. Hmm. There was a highly dressed woman in church, and he was sitting behind her, and she had a cootie, a louse coming down the side of her neck.
Ooh.
And he wrote this poem, somebody would give the gift that see ourselves as others see us.
Oh, dear.
And so that exalted feeling might conceal a louse. Mm. Okay, what's next?
Well, Deborah writes, I'm living on Social Security disability. I tried tithing, but I don't have enough money left over to pay my bills. Does it count as tithing if I volunteer my time?
Of course it does. Listen, God isn't some Philadelphia lawyer or New York Wall Street accountant trying to keep record on you. The idea is, what's in your heart? And I'm giving of myself. I mean, what could be more wonderful than giving of myself? I'm going to tithe my time. How wonderful. You're going to spend time helping the poor and the needy and lifting up the downtrodden. It's marvelous.
I think, you know, sometimes it's a lot harder to give our time than our money.
Oh, absolutely. You can write a check and, hey, here it is. Get out of my life. But the fact that I want to make you part of my life, that's beautiful.
All right. Well, Carol writes, the Bible addresses infidelity as a reason for divorce. If that's true, are either parties ever allowed to marry again, or do they have to remain single? Good question.
Well, as I understand it, if you have a reason for divorce, and Paul had what's called a Pauline privilege, and he said, if the unbeliever is pleased to depart, let him depart. The brother or sister is not bound in a case like that. So I think if you've got an adulterous situation and the marriage is dissolved, the other party is not bound by those marriage vows. So that's the way I would read it.
Yeah, okay. Tammy writes, I strongly suspect that my husband had an affair several years ago. He refuses to discuss it. I've tried to forget about it, but I am haunted by what may have happened, and I am bitter that he may have gotten off scot-free by not addressing the situation. Can you give me advice as to how I may get past this and forgive the unknown? Wow.
You go to the Lord and think of what you've done and how much he's forgiven you. And the Bible says we're to forgive one another, and even as Christ has forgiven us. I mean, we're not to hold grudges.
Don't you think he ought to confess us? That's her husband.
She didn't even know anything happened. Why should he confess? I mean, you know, if he doesn't want to confess, he doesn't confess. Maybe nothing happened, and maybe he said
maybe nothing happened,
and she's just suspicious. Look, envy and jealousy and that kind of thing is vicious. It's one of the deadly sins. And I just think that the idea of saying, well, I think my husband had an affair, but I'm not sure, and he didn't confess it and he refuses to.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. That's ridiculous. I mean, forgive him. Does he love you? Does he take care of you? Do you have a good life together? Put this aside. Mm-hmm. It's really between him and the Lord. You say, well, he got away. Well, what do you want him to do? Go to jail? I mean, this, you know, what?
That's a good point.
Really? Mm-hmm. What do you want him to do? Flagellate? Have somebody beat him? I mean, it's crazy. So I just think this kind of suspicion is corrosive. It's tearing you up, and it's tearing up your marriage. Let it go. You forgive him just like Jesus forgave you. And what do? Go over all the sins that you've committed your life. And ask the Lord to forgive you from this. Mm-hmm. And if he'll forgive you, then you've got to forgive other people. That's why I can't hold anger against somebody else. I just ask God to forgive me. I need grace. I need the grace of God. And I'm willing to extend grace to others because the Lord extended to me. Okay?
Amen. Beautifully said, Pat. And thank you so much. We are going to move
Bless
on now.
You.